For nearly two centuries, the Babcock Building has stood in waiting for its history to be spoken or for its demise to be met. Its history is full of horror and irony. Colombians are gleefully unaware of its twisted past, and we may never know the full story of what went on inside of these walls. This is the second oldest asylum in the United States, the South Carolina Lunatic Asylum. Most know that the asylum was built between 1822 and 1827, and was built featuring the latest fire resistance and patient security technology. It was a massive project aimed at bettering the lives of the mentally ill. It truly was a city within a city, taking over 200 acres. It became a Columbia landmark, with its famous 12-sided dome becoming a classic piece of the Columbia skyline. However, I'm not here to shed light on what's already known. Its mystique has drawn visitors from near and far, and sparked a rivalry between explorers and law enforcement. We are the former, here to explore not only its present state, but its lesser-known past. Maybe the history the Department of Mental Health would rather you forget. Are you familiar with Pee-wee Gaskins? No, not the fun-loving Pee-wee from our childhoods. I'm talking about Pee-wee Gaskins, the infamous serial killer and cannibal from South Carolina. Now, I'm not going to go too deep into this guy's past, mostly because I don't like reading about it, but this guy was about as horrible of a human being as you could possibly be. And yes, he was kept here in these walls before his execution. There's not much information on his time here in the building. However, there is one account of a nurse, Nurse Brico, who says she's seen everything from suicide attempts, to attacks on nurses, to people chasing imaginary chickens down hallways, and the intake of death row inmates. Brico accounts that one day she saw Donald Pee-wee Gaskins escorted by four policemen into an elevator bound for the fifth floor, which housed inmates in maximum security cells. Gaskins was one of the last to die by the electric chair in the state. This room here used to be the crematory. I've been exploring this place for a long time, and I remember seeing the crematory oven amongst other equipment housed in this room. Before the real estate developers bought this land with the intention of turning it into luxury apartments, there were a lot of horrible things laying around, including stretchers, shackles and cells, even plenty of lobotomy chairs complete with the head straps. So much has been removed, including all of the files that were inside of the offices, which begs the question, why? These files could possibly have had more information on Gaskins' time here in the asylum. Is it possible that they are trying to hide the dirty past of the asylum? Which brings me to my next subject of discussion, the transorbital lobotomy. Now, it is said that its doctors never once sterilized a patient or performed a lobotomy at the South Carolina Lunatic Asylum. The lobotomy is, of course, the popular brain operation of the 40s and 50s that is now considered one of the cruelest procedures in the annals of medicine. However, this was proven to be a lie, not only because of all of the lobotomy chairs I personally witnessed, but nurses have given accounts of patients who had received lobotomies. Linda McLam, a nurse who worked at the Bull Street Asylum in the early 1960s, accounted that she witnessed the aftermath of a transorbital lobotomy on one poor patient. The woman, a schizophrenic, found a frog in the courtyard one day during recreation and hid it inside of her body cavity, where it later died. When staff discovered what she had done, McLam said, the irreversible brain operation was ordered. McLam quotes, "I'll never forget it. When I came back to the hospital on Monday, she had two black eyes. She had had a lobotomy. That's the reason she had two black eyes. They let her on A ward after that because she was like a zombie. The procedure made it easier for them to control her. I never did hear much about her after that. I guess that was the straw that broke the camel's back. That frog. End quote. McLam's recollections from Bull Street paint a portrait pulsating with horror, sadness, and cover-ups. In her memories, C Ward was a hellish place where chain-link fencing stretched from floor to ceiling to protect staff members from patients, a neverland where patients' sobs mixed with the jangling of keys and the clanging of doors to create a bleak soundtrack. "I didn't see any improvement," McLam explained. "There was no hope. None of the patients said anything about going home. It's almost like they were forgotten." Now, even though overcrowding was a problem in the asylum's past, you will be surprised to know that the asylum lost 30% of its patients every year. I guess that crematory was working overtime. The asylum took in a massive amount of patients, more than staff could handle, and took everyone, including slaves, during a time of much prejudice. Some of the deaths were due to direct patient neglect, such as the story of a patient who was put in a cell due to bad behavior. The nurses were supposed to check on her every 2 hours, however, forgetting about her for over a week led to her untimely death inside of the cell. No, the leading cause of the deaths of the South Carolina Insane Asylum was a mystery, until they had discovered the disease pellagra. See, the patients were fed a diet so horrible that they lacked vitamin B3, niacin. Pellagra causes diarrhea, dermatitis, dementia, and death. Yes, that's right, dementia. In absolute cruel irony, going to the asylum for mental health relief drove patients into insanity, and some even deeper. Thousands died from this epidemic at the Bull Street Asylum. What you're seeing here is the view from the cupola, or the iconic tower that could be seen from many points in the city. It was a source of identity for the city, and tragically, this may be the last footage taken from inside the tower's top. This was the central stairwell encased in wooden slats to keep patients from leaping over the railing. As if it all wasn't bad enough, the grounds were used as a prison camp for Union soldiers from October of 1864 to February of 1865 during the Civil War. This was a drawing of the camp made by one of the prisoners. Horrors from this chapter of the Bull Street Asylum are surely lost in time. Now, I want to take this time to allow you to take in the energy of the building and see the deterioration. Feel free to scrub through and look at what you find interesting, but be sure to check back near the end of the video for the resolution. I'll put a timestamp in the description for that.
Reddit Live is fun though, because so many people would join. You don't need followers or anything.
Now, the middle of the wing we're in right now, which is behind the garages that I'm pointing at, has proven to be particularly difficult to get into. Years ago, I read a creepypasta post about the coordinator's office, which, looking from the courtyard, you can see the coordinator's office by its much bigger window than all of the surrounding windows. Unfortunately, I don't think it's possible to get in without breaking down one of the surrounding garages.
Thank you. That's where the black marble room is. Are you good? What? Is your breathing good?
It's kind of weird, but...
A little heavy?
Yeah.
It wears off in a couple days.
Is it locked?
Yeah, they got it locked. Straight out of Poltergeist. Maybe it's this way.
This was one of the many cells inside of the Babcock Asylum, and to think that this could have been the cell that one patient was forgotten in haunts me to my core.
Thank you.
I wish I could end the video right here and inspire more urban explorers to do their thing. Unfortunately, the evolving tragedies connected to the asylum continue even to this day. Literally, this day. I made this video in the beginning as a simple urban exploration of a historic building, but instead finished it as a memorial to a piece of Columbia's history. It's a huge loss for Columbia's culture, and as Mayor Benjamin puts it, the city grew up around it. It has been such a centerpiece of the architectural fabric of Columbia. This is the equivalent of our Notre Dame fire.